to day 19. We are here right down the slope from the temple. You can see up behind me on my left, the corner of the Temple Mount. And you can see that we're on a very steep slope down into this village. And the reason we're here is because we're also going to go toward the lowest point in this valley, which is the Pool of Siloam. Today we're going to be speaking about Jesus and the temple as a bridge toward his passion and death. So as we begin this reflection today, I would like to read from John 2:16, which speaks specifically about Jesus' attitude of the temple and why it's so important for us to reflect on this during our pilgrimage. 13. It says, "The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He was in the temple, and he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and money changers at their businesses. And making a whip out of cords, he drove them all with sheep and men out of the temple, and he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, "Take these things away. You shall not make my father's house a place of trade." When his disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." So it's very interesting, the perspective we're getting from here, and why this is such an important place to come as we enter into this next part of what we profess about Jesus, when we say that he is the Christ, that he died for us and died for our sins. So the temple, as Jesus says here, is a place of prayer, and it's his father's house. It's a place he knew well. Right in this temple, we've seen those gates, the Hula gates, where they have those steps going upward. And this is where they think, again, I think I mentioned it before, where Jesus was taken to be presented in the temple when he was just a baby. It was in the same place where he stayed when he was 12 years old, and they had to go find him, Mary and Joseph, when he was going about his father's business. He went here often with his disciples and his apostles to preach and to teach. And so the temple is this privileged place. It's certainly not a place of commerce. It's not a place of trade. But even after Jesus rose from the dead, the apostles continued to worship in the temple, continued to see it as a sacred place. It says in Acts 2:43, the apostles revered the temple after the resurrection. And it says, day by day, they attended the temple together. And then further in Acts 3:1, it says, now Peter and John, remember this wonderful story. When Peter and John were going to the temple to pray, they were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. And that's when they found the lame man. And they said to him, and this was right outside of the beautiful gate that we saw from the Temple Mount before. They said to him, we cannot give you gold or silver, but we will give you what we do have. And that is, in the name of Jesus Christ, stand up and walk. And that's exactly what happened. So this temple is a place which speaks so much about who God is. And let's not forget that he also told us, when he was speaking of the Holy Spirit, that we ourselves would be temples of the Spirit. But at the end of this gospel that we just read, and this is a key thing to remember as we speak about his passion, this temple, the temple that he was speaking about, is the temple of his body, destroyed but raised up in 3 days. So in a certain sense, this is the beginning of the last days of this temple. And it's the beginning of a new temple again, which is each and every one of us. And, you know, it's funny that even when Jesus, well, unusual, right? When Jesus was hanging on the cross, this was one of the insults they spewed at him. Oh, he who said that he could build the temple in 3 days, I want you to come down off that cross. I mean, it's interesting how it just points again and again to one of these central mysteries of the life of Jesus, which points to his identity as God, and that is his death. So again, Jesus identified himself with the temple as God's definitive dwelling among men. It's the privileged place of encounter with God. And so therefore his death was presaged by the destruction of the temple, and it ushered in the dawning of a new age in the history of salvation. Don't forget what Jesus said to the Samaritan woman. This is a gospel which is usually read on this Sunday during Lent. It's an option that priests can always read. And so when Jesus had this conversation with the Samaritan woman, he said, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. Because there in Samaria, they had a mountain where they would also worship, just like here in Jerusalem. And so he's ushering in that new, the new part of the history of salvation, where we will worship in spirit and in truth. Everything that happened in this place, and when he was talking about the temple, and we'll speak about this in just a second when we go down to the pool, when he cured the blind man, this whole context of the Feast of Tabernacles, it was really, putting fire underneath the pot and making, you know, the leaders at that time, the Jewish leaders at that time, just boil over, because it was an absolute blasphemy to say that you were identifying yourself with God. And so everything was coming together again in God's plan to lead to the condemnation and death of Jesus. Okay, this is what he says. Remember, if he is telling the truth, he can say, there is something greater than Jonah here. there is something greater than Solomon. But even more important, there is something greater than the temple here. So we've made our way here down to this pool of Siloam. This is a very special place to be, and I want to thank actually Abu Musa, who is the man who is the guardian of this pool that has been here for centuries. This pool was actually made back in the time of Hezekiah. And why is it in this spot? Just to give you an idea, and you'll see this when we give you some takes of what it looks like from the temple, from Jerusalem, the actual walls right now. And there's this incline, this slope that goes all the way to this point where the Kidron Valley and the Valley of Gehenna meet. So at this lowest point, a pool of water gathers. But it's not just because of rain or a cistern type of thing, because it's on the top of the earth. It's actually fed by the Gishon Spring, which is right behind us, and I'll show you what that actually looks like. And that's why you can hear water constantly flowing, because it comes up right behind me and it flows down and further in to the whole area that used to be the Pool of Siloam. Now, it was built so many thousands of years ago because the people in Jerusalem actually needed water. And this was a spring that was outside of the ancient city of the Jebusites. In fact, these caves of Hezekiah, again, which are right behind me, that when you come, you can actually walk through them, they were hand-hewn. And it's so that the people in the city could go, being protected from being attacked or anything, and they could gather, they could get the water that they needed for their own livelihood. Now, the city of David was right here, and it eventually moved to where we see the city of Jerusalem right now. But again, this pool fed that city for years, and they even think that through some older tunnels around this spring is how David, before he was king, actually came into the ancient city of the Jebusites and conquered it. So all of that is history. But this again is the lowest point, but it's fresh water, it's living water. Again, the Siloam Spring. So what I wanted to read now as we reflect upon this reality of Jesus in the temple is from the Gospel of John chapter 9. And this is an important event that happened right here. So we're going to actually take a look at this spring, and I'm going to read the Gospel for you. Bringing together the temple and this spring, it says, "As he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he is born blind?' Jesus answered, 'It was not this man or his parents who sinned, but that the works of God may be made manifest in him.' We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night comes when one can no longer work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." As he said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and anointed the man's eyes with the clay, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent or the sent one. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar said, "Is not this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "It is he." Others said, "No, it is not him, but someone who looks like him." He said, "I am the man." They said to him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' As I went and washed, I received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." Well, then eventually, the blind man did find Jesus again in the temple. And this is what their conversation was about. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is it, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and it is he who speaks to you." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped. So this is what the Gospel of John tells us about what happened here in this pool of Siloam. It's a story that we've heard many, many times, and it has a significance that goes beyond just the flesh. It goes into the spirit. But the most important thing right now that I want to emphasize as we're here looking at these living waters is that this man declared, "I believe." He had a personal encounter with the Lord. He had an encounter with him in the temple. And he believed in him as soon as he knew who it was that gave him his sight. The trek down from the temple to this pool is extremely arduous when you see. When you don't see, it's much more difficult. So you can imagine as he was going back up, able to see, all of his friends and neighbors said, "Oh my gosh, this is the man who was blind. How is it that he can see?" We don't know exactly why Jesus sent him all the way down here. Perhaps it was to give testimony of his faith. Perhaps it was to make sure that everyone knew what happened. But everyone did see him. But I think, probably because of the name of this pool, the sent one, the one who was sent, is the reason why Jesus took him here. Because when this man who could not see, but he was able to hear, just like Abraham, Ob Audire, he heard God speak. And then his faith was made strong. Just like this man, he heard and then he saw. So this is a very clear relation to what we've been talking about. But I want to give you kind of a context and tell you a few things that I think are important about this gospel that help us to understand the significance of this event. First of all, this scene actually happened. He cured the blind man the day after the Feast of Sukkot. That's an ancient feast of the Israelite people that has, you can see it even today, they build these tents. These tabernacles, it's also called the Feast of Tabernacles, outside of their homes. It reminds them that God saved them when they were wandering through Egypt. They keep the roof slightly open so they can see the stars of the sky and say, it's not just me, I can't protect just myself, but I have to rely on the protection of God who saved us so long ago. And at the end of Sukkot, it's actually a whole time of prayer for rain. It's a very dry country in general, water. This is why the spring is so important. Water is essential. And so usually after Sukkot, there's a rain. And so as soon as they feel that first raindrop through their tent, they say, okay, God always is faithful. He keeps his covenant. So this is when Jesus cured him. But it's important to know that during that feast, the priests would come down from the temple with a golden jug, and they would come into this pool and they would fill it with water. And every day they would go back up. And they would walk around the altar and they would pour that water onto the altar of sacrifice. On the seventh day, they would do it again, the last and greatest day of the feast. And they would pour that water onto the altar of sacrifice. And on that day, they would walk around seven times. So everyone knew what was happening. And so because of that, the water also was a way for them to say, we know that God will always protect us. He is faithful. And we will pray for what we need. We're going to sow the seed. We're going to have the crops. And so we need that as well. Now, the other thing that I wanted to mention that happens during the Feast of Sukkot, it used to when they had the temple, is every day at dusk in the evening, they would light lamps in the outer courtyard. And these lamps were so large that they say that they would even light up part of the city of Jerusalem. So why is that significant? Both the water and the light. Well, first of all, as we've been talking about, water and light are symbols of faith. That's why we have our lamp of faith. And this is why, thanks to Abu Musa, he allowed me to put this staff, our staff from Abraham, here in this living water. So on this last day of the feast, as it says in the Gospel of John 7, Jesus actually goes into the temple. Okay, this is the time when they had just washed and when they had just seen this light, this offering of the water poured onto the altar, when Jesus says, "I am the living water. If you are thirsty, come to me and drink." In the context of that feast, and speaking about this pool of Siloam, What is he saying? What is he revealing about who God is? This question that we're always asking. He is saying, I am the one who will give you life, living water. I am the sent one, like the name of this pool is. I am the one that you need. I am the one that you need to pray for to come down from heaven. Now the second thing, which is also interesting regarding this feast, like I said, that fire that was lit in the temple. Well, if you look in John 8:12, the next day, in the court of the lamps, after the feast was over, when it was no longer lit, Jesus went back into the temple before he cured the blind man that we just read in chapter 9, and he said, I am the light of the world. I am the light that you've been looking for, that you've been seeing during this feast, but it's me. So the leaders sought to have him put to death. Remember, we're talking about this day, Jesus and his relation to the temple, because this is our sort of our segue, our bridge into this other part of our profession of faith. He was crucified, died, and was buried. And so they were very upset with his affirmation, challenging the people who heard him. I am the Messiah. I am the one that you are looking for. I am God. That's actually what we profess today. Now, I also want to talk about three very interesting things about what happened when Jesus cured this man. Ever since I heard this story as a child, I always thought, well, it's really weird that he would spit in the ground and make mud. So why on earth would he do something like spit into the ground and make mud for someone's eyes? Well, first of all, you know, as a child, I always thought, well, it's actually very bad manners to spit. Why would someone do that? And actually, it's very common in the culture here for people to do that. You see it all over. Well, saliva itself, being a biochemist, saliva, even Galen said this, you know, he was one of the best physicians in the Roman Empire. He said that it actually has curing properties. There is stuff in saliva which not only begins to break down the food that you eat, it actually has enzymes. So like when a mother kisses the wound of her child, or even a worse, you know, a more graphic example, when a dog comes and licks the wounds of somebody who's on the street, it actually helps to cure those wounds. So there is something which is curative in saliva. Even Vespasian, they said, one of the Roman gods told him, apparently, if you spit on a blind man's eyes, he will be made to see. So this was a common understanding from ancient times that there was something about saliva. But it's also, I'll just tell you one other tradition which is interesting. The Jewish people, apparently, in this time did believe that the saliva of the firstborn had very special properties, healing properties, which is very interesting because if Jesus is transmitting and showing the people, not just with his words saying that I am the Son of God, but showing them with his actions that he can even cure, that he is the light, that he is the water, and he cures a man with his spittle, he's saying that I am the firstborn of the Father, I am the Son of God. So let's talk a little bit about the mud. So he makes mud out of this. Well, let's remember one of the things which is not allowed according to very detailed Jewish law, and that is you cannot work on the Sabbath. Remember we spoke about that? Well, that means that they've defined that making mud is actually work. And so they actually stipulate, if you're going to spit, you must spit on a rock or in a bush and not on the dust, lest you work by making mud. Jesus, again, with his actions, is saying, I am above the law. In fact, I gave you the law by spitting and making that mud, that clay. And he puts it on the man's eyes. He's actually working. But more than that, he's making clay from dust. We are dust From dust we came, and to dust we will go. Adam was made from dust. What is he doing with this action? He is making a new creation. He's allowing this man to see again. He is giving him new flesh. And by coming here to this pool, by washing, he's giving him new spirit. He's giving him true sight, the sight of faith. The pool is something that provided life. It always provided life, the sent one. And remember what we spoke about when we talked about Ezekiel. Remember his vision about the temple? His vision that water would come from the east side of the temple and flow down and make those salty waters clean again? We talked about that when we were in Sodom. This is clean water. This is the water that comes down out of the temple and gives us true sight. It gives us life. This is why we're here. I can't resist being here to do the same as the man born blind. Here we have these columns that are from the Byzantine church that marked this place. The first Christians knew how important this was. So with great faith, as I wash my eyes, you can keep in your own heart and say in your own heart what your prayers are, what you need to be cured of, what strength you might need from Christ. And with this gesture, I unite that to what you most need. Guardian of the Siloam pool, and thanks to him we were able to go down. Thank you. How long have you been here?
I've been here.
He was born here. He was born in the water, so he takes very good care of it. Thank you so much. He has a beautiful garden right in front, and make sure this place will always be protected, right? Wonderful. Thank you. So back out here so that we can see into this valley. You know, there's still quite a way down to get to the pool if you walk. To think about that poor blind man that had to not only come down from the temple, but then go all the way back up. He probably went up rejoicing, as it says in the Psalms, you know, went down weeping, but coming back rejoicing, having experienced this not only the healing of his own body, but also the great power and strength that comes with faith. So as we come to the end of this day, I just want to invite each and every one of us to stop and think, not only as we washed our face and our eyes in the pool of Siloam, what we would like to petition our Lord that he cure us of, that we let him touch us, you know, that we experience his touch, that we experience the life-giving powers of his person. But perhaps we can also think about the temple. This temple which is ourselves, this temple which is our own person, our own hearts. And look and see if there's money changers in there, if there's a lot of traffic in there, a lot of foot traffic, a lot of noise. Or is it really a house of prayer? Is it a house of encounter with the Father's presence? And if it's not, we can certainly ask Jesus, take that whip, drive them away. Drive them away and usher my life into that life of the new temple where I can truly worship you in spirit and in truth. So know that from here, this beautiful city of Jerusalem, we are praying for you, and I look forward to seeing you again tomorrow as our pilgrimage in faith continues. God bless you.